Now we move on to the next item of business on the order paper, which is a motion on the proposed closure of regional electoral offices. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to end. One amendment has been selected and it's published on the marshalled list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to end. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes with concern the proposals from the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland to close regional electoral offices in Ballymena, Banbridge, Londonderry, Newtownabbey, Newtownards and Omagh. Believes that this will damage democracy in Northern Ireland, lead to fewer people on the electoral register and to a diminished role for the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland in local schools and communities, and calls on the Secretary of State, the Northern Ireland Office and the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland to retain and fund adequately all regional offices currently under threat of closure.
I call Mr. Tom Buchanan to move the motion, please.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to move the motion before the House this afternoon and to speak solely to the motion. I note the amendment which has been selected and just wish to inform the House at the outset of the debate that we will not be supporting the amendment. We don't believe the Executive should pursue the transfer of the functions of the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland, but rather work with the NIO and a bid to keep the offices open and to ensure that they are properly and adequately funded. The proposed closure of the regional electoral offices in Ballymena, Banbridge, Londonderry, Newtownabbey, Newtownards and Omagh has caused widespread concern, not only from the unions and employees, but also amongst all shades of political persuasion right across Northern Ireland. Proposals to centralise the 6 regional offices in Belfast at a time when we are already witnessing decreasing turnouts at elections in Northern Ireland simply doesn't make sense. With a turnout of 62.3% in 2007, down to 54.7% in 2011, and most recently 54.2% in 2016. This will further damage democracy, lead to fewer people on the electoral register and to a diminished role for the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland in our local schools and amongst our local communities. For many of the electorate within the rural communities, the regional offices are their first point of contact, whether that be for the elderly, or for the young, or the disabled, or first-time voters, or those who have literacy problems, whatever it is. This is the first point of contact for them who require help in filling their registration forms, need electoral identity cards, or have any other difficulties or problems that they need resolved. This face-to-face contact with staff is invaluable, and to lose such will have detrimental consequences for the electoral process right across Northern Ireland. And I know that there is this aim to pursue the online registration, and while I have no difficulty with the pursuit of that, of the online registration, this in isolation to the regional offices will fail to deliver, given the ongoing infrastructural problems with broadband throughout our rural areas, and many people who simply will not utilise online services. Such a system will only be successful if run in conjunction with the electoral offices. The regional offices also provide an excellent service within our schools in encouraging our youth to register and providing them with the electoral identity card. And the question is quite rightly being asked: if the regional office closes, who then will promote the register and provide the outreach services in and around our schools to instil the confidence of the electoral system into our younger generation? In looking through the 2015-2018 Electoral Office for Northern Ireland Corporate Plan, I noted their mission statement is to ensure public confidence in the efficiency and integrity of the voter registration and election process in Northern Ireland. Yet it has to be said today that the very proposals that they are pursuing poses to do the very opposite to the mission statement that they have put out. The regional offices are the anchor for the electoral system in Northern Ireland. We take a ship and remove the anchor from it, then that ship's going to go all over the place and probably at the end of the day sink. And you know, if we don't keep the regional offices the anchor for the regional for the electoral services in Northern Ireland, there's no doubt that it will diminish and it will sink. Looking at the risk assessment within the corporate plan, the potential risks are extremely worrying, and I know these are only the potential risks that are flagged up. But with regard to the introduction of online registration, the potential risk is that the technical or operational problems associated with the introduction of the new system could lead to a loss of public confidence, or that the electorate register will not be accurate and comprehensive, leading to reputational damage and loss of public confidence. They go on to the risk assessment regarding resources. Electoral register will not be comprehensive or accurate, resulting in recommendation of full canvas and a further demand on resources. For staff resources, the potential risk for it is inadequate staffing could result in statutory deadlines not being met, elections not run successfully, and reputational damage to the electoral office for Northern Ireland. Again, whenever we look at the service delivery, unable to deliver an effective service to the public and loss of public confidence and so forth. And we know that this is only the potential risk, but let's weigh this up against the fact of what happened in England whenever they introduced the online registration. There were some 800,000 voters who were lost to the online registration. Now, I think that causes each one of us grave concern, and it raises concern for the future of the electoral system in Northern Ireland should they continue to pursue the proposals that they have before us. And that is why today we are calling on the Secretary of State and the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland to reconsider these proposals and to adequately fund the regional offices within Northern Ireland. It's disappointing. Yet I suppose it's not surprising that these proposals have been put forward, with the closure of at least two, if not three, offices imminent prior to a consultation process, and without any discussion with the First and Deputy First Minister, and little or no discussion with the local councils as to how they could accommodate the offices and how this system could be funded if it was within the local council areas. And I say today that that in itself is an absolute disgrace. We are calling on the Secretary of State, we are calling on the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland to withdraw the proposals, to rethink their position and to enter into discussions with the First and Deputy First Minister, with the local councils in the area, and see how this matter can be properly funded, can be set into the setting within perhaps local council and still continue to deliver for the people of Northern Ireland. I support the motion and urge the chamber here today to support the motion before the House.
I call Mr. Duffy Mackay to move the amendment.
I get a last count, can I thank the proposers of this motion for bringing it to the House, and can I move the amendment on behalf of Sinn Féin. Obviously, I think all 108 members received a letter from NHTSA concerning the action that has been taken. And of course, the letter from NHTSA also highlights the lack of accountability that there is regarding local politicians. I think it refers to the unaccountability of the NIO and the Chief Electoral Officer. So that is why we have put forward an amendment to the original motion that actually at the end of the day this is a decision that we should be taking. We should be taking a decision, in my view, that safeguards this service, especially in regard to rural communities which are going to be acutely impacted by the decision to close these particular offices. Because I stood on the picket line a couple of weeks ago in Ballymena with the local workers in that electoral office. I did so along with other MLAs from all the parties locally. So we were all unanimously opposed to the decision there. But we are all 108 locally elected politicians powerless to do anything about this. And that is why we should see these small, and it has to be said, they are small, but significant functions transfer to Belfast. Because you look at the responsibilities that we do have in terms of education, in terms of policing, in terms of justice, in terms of housing, we all work together, we make decisions in those areas. And 10, 20, 30 years ago, there have been a lot of issues about decisions in those particular areas locally. So then, in that context, surely setting up an independent but accountable electoral service should not be an issue, and I don't believe it is. We have shown in recent times how mature an assembly and executive we can be, and I think we should move forward with confidence that we should take on more powers to ensure that we protect local services and protect local workers. Because if you look at the list of the offices that are going to be impacted, if you look at Ballymena, Banbridge, Omagh, Derry, Newtownabbey and Newtownards, if all of those were to close, that would leave a huge gap in the rural constituencies. There's also an impact when it comes to older people as well. I mean, there's been much discussion from the Electoral Office about online registration, doing things through the internet. A lot of older people, and some younger people as well, would rather do things by pen and paper, would rather go to their local office and seek advice on how to fill out forms, which can be quite intimidating to some of us at times as well, in terms of securing that very, very basic right to have a vote. And of course, the same applies in terms of requesting photographic identification as well, because in recent years it has become harder and harder and harder to secure your vote. So in that context, certainly, it does not make sense that the service and the support to secure that vote has been withdrawn and taken away from those on the ground who need it more than ever. Because I remember, and I'm sure most people have picked up certain anecdotes from the canvas of the recent election. I remember going to Carrie, the far north coast of Antrim, outside Ballycastle, and speaking to a man who was coming 100 years of age, and he was going to go down to the local school at Barnish to place his vote, and he said he had his ID and he had a piece of photographic identification with a disability badge on it. Of course, it was not acceptable, so he went and he tried to get his vote and he did not get it. So there are so many cases like that where people are losing their vote unnecessarily. And, you know, if all these decisions roll out, where does he go to help getting a photographic ID to ensure he's on the register? He may have to go to Belfast from Kerry. And, of course, he also didn't have a computer in the house as well. You know, so that goes to show the kind of barriers there are for certain members of our community, for certain electors in our constituency. So these are all big, big questions, and they need to be answered first, and we should not be putting the cart before the horse, because certainly in the context of Ballymena, in 4 months, in October, it is planned by the Electoral Office that the Ballymena office will close. Yet another closure for Ballymena town, and the Electoral Office are simply allowing the lease to lapse. And I've contacted Graham Shields, the Chief Executive, as have all the local MLAs in regard to this, and he replied that it would not have been sensible to enter into a new lease in Ballymena in light of plans for the introduction of digital registration. And he said, I would encourage you to participate in the public consultation exercise when it is launched in the autumn of 2016. Why would anybody represent North Antrim participate in that consultation when the office is effectively already closed? You know, the decision, it is quite clear, has already been made. The lease is being allowed to lapse, and I believe that the Electoral Office, for their own reasons, have agreed that that service should be centralised towards Belfast, towards Newtownabbey, initially, but certainly this is the shape of things to come. And I should say as well that the Electoral Office in Ballymena has served the people of North Antrim and indeed Mid-Ulster for many years. They've worked diligently and proactively. They've provided advice and support to not only the voters and those on the ground, but also to us as candidates, as party workers, as directors of elections. They have been absolutely fantastic in terms of the service they have provided for many, many years.
It was before his time, but he will also be aware that this is not the first time in North Antrim that we've suffered in relation to the proposals by the Electoral Office. The Electoral Office was in Ballymena and was closed and moved to Ballymena. So we have seen a gradual withdrawal, and I concur with his comments in relation to the staff in Ballymena, but will he also recognise that this is yet another issue that has affected North Antrim for the second time, because the first time it was removed from Ballymena?
I concur absolutely, and I do remember Ballymena Office. I was in it, so I've been about for a long, long time. And Ballymena is a case in point. We've seen the impact that has been seen in Ballymena in terms of job closures, in terms of the withdrawal of services like the Electoral Office, and the impact there is still being felt. And unfortunately, what we see in Ballymena is almost a mirror image of what happened in Ballymena over the past 10 to 15 years. So the Electoral Office have done a fantastic job. They provided a fantastic service across all the constituencies, and quite simply, they do not deserve to be treated like this. We need to see if the Electoral Office are to have a consultation, let's have a fair consultation, let's not be making any decisions beforehand. And of course, the Electoral Office workers within our rural constituencies, in terms of all these offices that have been outlined, were proactive in their work. They did the outreach to schools. They set up photographic ID clinics in the many villages and hamlets across the rural constituencies. And all of that is absolutely essential, because you have places like Antrim, North Antrim, Tyrone, Fermanagh, where Belfast is very, very far away. And we quite acutely see the need for those services to continue for the time ahead. So to conclude, Alas Cán Cóir, I do agree with the proposers of the motion that the NAO and the Chief Electoral Officer need to reconsider these proposals. But we also need to step up to the plate, because this decision as regards local offices, it's going to affect local workers, and it's going to have a huge impact on local democracy. So I believe that the people who should be making the decision in regard to this need to be local politicians.
I call Robin Swan.
Deputy Speaker, in regard to the regional officers, I think, and I apologise for going back to North Antrim, because it's the area I think the last speaker and one of the contributors represented. But it's the state of the Electoral Office in Ballymena, and I think the support that has been shown by all the parties and the support of the office and the work that is done there. And one of the things we have to concentrate is the fact that the office has been closed while the consultation is ongoing and only starting. So to us in North Antrim and to Mid-Ulster and even to a certain section of East Londonderry who use the Ballymena office, this decision has already been made. Mr Buchanan, in his opening comments, made reference to the input of local councils. Mr Deputy Speaker, I want to put on record in this House the work of Mid and East Antrim Council and the work that they did to try to facilitate a continual presence and the offers of premises for the Electoral Office to retain a presence in Ballymena while the consultation was ongoing. And I think that work was invaluable, and I hope it bears fruit. I'm not prepared just to give up already. Deputy Speaker, one of the reasons that the Electoral Office has put forward that their ability to close regional offices is the registration online and what a great success that will be. Previous speakers have already mentioned the invaluable service the face-to-face relies on, but we just recently witnessed within the last week the complete collapse of the online registration in England and Wales due to people trying to register for the Brexit campaign that was coming forward. So we in Northern Ireland should learn from that lesson. We have an excellent facility in place that relies and supports the face-to-face service that we need to provide, plus an online facility could be there to be enhanced. But what we in Northern Ireland can't forget is that the work, the independent work of the Electoral Office, and that's why I can't support the amendment, or why we can't support the amendment, is the reliance that it relies on independent, because their work relies as much as not who gets on the electoral register, but the work that they do to ensure that the people get on it should be on it, and it's not abused or abused, misused. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in the last monitoring round, our Finance Minister allocated £5.3 million to the Electoral Office for the running of the last Assembly elections. And I think surely from this House and from this call today and from this motion, I know we've no ministerial response, that some monies could be found to retain the presence of those officers, at least while the consultation was ongoing, to allow that democratic process to take part. Because going back to the Ballymena office in particular, and the staff that work there. And again, I would like to thank and congratulate the work that they do. For although we have seen pickets and reduced labour, I do know that the staff there have made sure that everything is in place, and they've went the extra mile to make sure that no service fails while they're there. But while we look at those staff as individuals about the relocation that's been offered, the Ballymena office have been offered relocation to Mullusk for a temporary short period until the Mullusk office is closed and then they're transferred to Belfast. So there's no doubt this is about a centralisation of our electoral office in Northern Ireland. But when you look at the personal level of this decision, of a family working in that office who have already lost two breadwinners from the same house from job losses in Michelin, to now look at another job loss because of the decisions of the electoral office, it's the impact it's going to have yet again on Ballymena. This House in its last sitting passed a rural needs bill that would look specifically to make sure that our rural population and our rural towns and villages and dwellers would not be adversely affected by decisions. And it's through that bill that I think the Northern Ireland office should also look to their responsibilities and duties. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we'll be supporting the motion, but unfortunately not the amendment.
I call Daniel McCrossan.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I stand today to support the motion. It's a very important issue across the whole of Northern Ireland, but again, it affects directly my constituency, which is the reason I'm standing speaking with this. It's somewhat ironic, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that we face probably the biggest decision of a generation this Thursday, and that we're standing here in this chamber to discuss the closures of electoral offices. Mr. Deputy Speaker, the SDLP stands full square behind the staff of these offices, and it is vital that this chamber also shows its support today and that we show solidarity in opposing these punitive and anti-democratic budget cuts. In today's debate, it's important to remember that over the last 6 years, electoral offices have faced a reduction already of 25% in their operating budgets, while the new proposals by the NIO amount to a further 17% reduction. These cuts have already impacted on the services available for rural communities such as my constituency, and yet again further cuts in the closing of electoral offices are not in Belfast, but they are spread across many towns that serve rural areas, and this in itself will have ramifications for local populations and rural communities. The budget cuts proposed are mainly due to the upcoming introduction of an online registration system, as alluded by the previous speakers. What consideration, Mr. Deputy Speaker, has been given as to the quality of broadband services in rural areas, and what consideration has been given to the fact that in my constituency and in others, as mentioned in this House, that there are many people, especially our older population, who have not access to a computer and are not computer literate? How are they supposed to register or receive advice if there are no regional offices? The question also has to be asked, Mr. Deputy Speaker, whether the Northern Ireland office proposals were subject to rural proofing legislation. The proposals put forward are to have a centralised office in Belfast with a helpline if anyone has any difficulties with the registration process. But I know firsthand, and I'm sure other members will agree, of how invaluable the human interaction within these offices has been in the past and continues to be. The advice given, for example, on having the right documents in order to in order or in having the registration form properly completed have proven valuable when we as members are assisting constituents with getting on the voting register. And as alluded to by Mr Buchanan and others, numbers are dropping year in and year out when it comes to elections, and we need to be doing more to encourage people to register to vote and to use their right to vote. This will decentralise that and I'm sure put many people off, particularly in rural communities. Mr Speaker, in terms of the Omagh office in my own constituency, it's important to remember that it serves both West Tyrone and Fermanagh and South Tyrone. And I'm sure that my colleague, Mr McPhillips, who also feels very strongly about this issue, will agree with me when I say it serves our constituencies very well. Martin Fox and his staff in the Omagh Electoral Office, whom I met and joined during the industrial action, provides a first-class service for the people of my constituency and indeed the neighbouring constituency of Fermanagh and South Tyrone. But that service is now at risk, as these proposals will lead to the loss of 4 full-time staff. The last thing that West Tyrone needs, Mr Speaker, or any other rural community for that matter at this time, is further job losses or redundancies, and certainly no further reduction in rural services. But it's not all just voter registration or nomination papers that the Electoral Office deals with. The Omagh Electoral Office serves the wider community through its outreach programme every year. Representatives visit 25 schools across the constituency, ensuring that our young people are properly informed and properly prepared for registering to vote for the first time, and stress the importance of using their vote. It is my concern, Mr Deputy Speaker, that this important outreach programme and the linking up with many secondary schools in West Tyrone and across many other constituencies will be completely hampered under the new arrangements proposed. In the long term, it is vital that all options are considered, for example, on how these regional offices could be facilitated and indeed linked to local councils. I know that the Omagh office is closely situated to our local council buildings, and consideration must be given as to how we can use these premises to house services for constituents, including services provided by the electoral offices. Mr Deputy Speaker, turning to today's amendment proposed by Sinn Féin, the SDLP will not be supporting it. We will be supporting the motion. The amendment calls on the devolution of electoral powers to Northern Ireland, where this Assembly would dictate our own fate. For obvious reasons, we will not be supporting the amendments, but we will be calling on the Secretary of State and the NAO to reconsider the decision and ensure that this local service is protected and ensure that it remains across Northern Ireland. To conclude, these cuts will dramatically impact upon the democratic rights of my constituents and others. Issues that specifically surround rural areas have not, in my opinion, been thoroughly considered, and outreach programmes for our young people would be severely hampered. Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker.
I call David Ford.
Mr Deputy Speaker, there's no doubt, particularly when we come just a few weeks after an Assembly election, that there will be considerable support in this chamber for the work which is done by the staff of local electoral offices. We all have a relationship with our local office. We all tend to get to know the staff over a period of years, although I do recall 5 years ago when I called into the Newtownabbey electoral office and a temporary member of staff looked to me and asked me if I had a connection with any of the political parties, so it's not perhaps always quite that clear. However, I'm happy to say that the permanent staff know me, possibly they know me rather too well. In that context, we can also welcome the work which they have done on issues like registration as well as on election running. I've certainly cooperated with them on assisting to ensure that all schools in South Antrim take the opportunity to see that those who are of rising voting age get the opportunity to register and are encouraged in that direction. So we have seen good work being done by electoral offices, but we also need to be realistic that just because something has worked well doesn't necessarily mean that the current pattern will continue to work well. I have concerns about the way the proposals have been put forward. It's absolutely clear that we have not seen any detailed strategic planning. We've seen an instant response, ad hoc decisions taken to deal with financial problems without proper consultation and without proper consideration of how the best way to provide electoral services might be. It might well be that we don't need the network of offices that we currently have if there were arrangements made for partnerships with local councils, if there are arrangements made perhaps for registration events to be run in consultation with citizen advice bureaus or other organisations in the community. Just because the existing pattern of offices has worked up to now doesn't necessarily mean that's the right way. What concerns me is the fact that we are being presented with a scheme for closures which is being implemented without any consultation in some cases. and a system which is being put forward without any real consideration of how to maintain the local contacts, which may not need a permanent office, but do require some sort of a local activity, some opportunity for the work to go on. There is no doubt that when we switched to individual registration a few years ago, we saw a reduction of numbers on the electoral register, and we need to ensure that we work hard to get the numbers as consistently high as they should be, because sadly, I know from experience, it's much easier to ensure that somebody is removed from the electoral register when they die than it is, which is of course the right thing to do, than it is to get somebody new who has moved into an area onto the electoral register. So the call in the motion to retain and fund adequately all regional offices currently under threat, I think, is an unrealistic call. I certainly think the comments which were passed by Mr. Swan, which was we shouldn't be doing this until we've worked out the long-term future, are more in terms of what the need is, but that's not what the motion actually says. And I do fear that there's some real mixed language in the amendment. The functions of the electoral office are both administrative functions and legal duties which they discharge on behalf of the Northern Ireland office in its responsibilities for running elections in Northern Ireland. I'm not sure how you actually transfer the administrative functions away from the NIO when the NIO will still retain the full legal functions and the legislative functions for ensuring that elections in Northern Ireland are run in a proper way. And I do think there is a real mix-up in the way the amendment is phrased, which means it is simply unworkable. We do have to be realistic in this Assembly that it's too easy to assume that we can continue to provide the pattern of services that we've been used to across a range of issues without any consideration of the realities of the difficult public finances we live with. Frankly, I'm not sure how we're going to face up to the difficult decisions around health, which will probably be required when Professor Bengoa reports, if we can't face up to the reality that we cannot simply knee-jerk and protect the complete pattern that we currently have in electoral services. Yes, we need to ensure we have some proper plans for the future. Yes, we need to ensure how we maintain local engagement. But to suggest that that is done simply by making no change whatsoever, it seems to me, is unrealistic. What we should be insisting on is a genuine, meaningful consultation around the way services will be delivered in the future, about the proper way of ensuring contact with local communities, about the proper way of ensuring that as we move towards online registration, that that is carried out in a meaningful way. But that doesn't mean that we can continue to pretend we can provide services without any change whatsoever.
I call Sydney Anderson.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I welcome this opportunity to speak today on this very important matter for people right across Northern Ireland. My colleagues and I have brought this motion before the House because we recognise the important role that the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland plays in our democracy. We are deeply concerned about the current proposals that are being brought forward, which, if implemented, would see the closure of regional electoral offices in Ballymena, Londonderry, Newtownabbey, Newtownards, Omagh and Banbridge, which is located in my constituency of Upper Ban. To date, we have already witnessed electoral offices having to deal with a 25% reduction in budgets over the past 6 years, with an additional 17% proposed for 2020. I am fully aware of the important role the electoral office in Banbridge plays in democracy and political procedures. I understand the office is currently has 4 full-time staff and 9 part-time employees, and they provide a key link for the public when they are doing things such as vote registration and receiving, submitting postal and proxy votes applications. They have also carried out a range of registration and electoral ID events, which have been focused on enhancing the number of people on the electoral register. I also want to commend the Regional Electoral Office for getting in contact with places of education to encourage the younger generation to become registered so that they can therefore fully participate in elections by exercising their democratic right to vote. Activities carried out by my local regional office in Banbridge is further replicated right across the regional offices.
Would the member give way?
Okay.
Would the member agree with me that the proposed closure of the electoral offices, including Newtownards, which services 170,000 people, which does an excellent job providing a good, friendly service, that such a loss will have a very negative effect, and that we are now also have lost the annual canvass. Do you agree that this will undermine the integrity of the electoral registration system?
And the member has an extra minute added to his speaking time.
Thank you, and I thank my colleague for that intervention, and I certainly would agree with everything that he says, that we can allow no further erosion of issues that they're bringing forward here and proposals that will further damage the electoral process, and I would certainly agree with his comments. A significant focus has been put on making increased use of technology to carry out online electoral registration. Whilst I welcome the fact that there are some positives from adopting this approach, it has to be recognised that there are other points to consider. Whilst we have seen enhanced rural broadband provision being provided in recent times, Mr Deputy Speaker, we are still facing many challenges as we seek to enhance provision right across Northern Ireland. It also has to be noted that there would be a number of people who might find it difficult to secure access to such technologies and to successfully complete registration. I therefore firmly believe that complete centralisation of the Electoral Office functions is not the way forward. In the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland's Business Plan 2015-2016, it is stated, the Electoral Office Northern Ireland is committed to the continuous improvement not only of the services it provides to the public and other stakeholders, but also of the leadership, support and development opportunities available to its staff. However, if the proposed closure of regional electoral offices takes place, I, as a political representative, am fearful that democracy could be damaged because the electoral office would simply no longer be able to play a key role in our communities. Moreover, it is highly likely that a significant number of staff would lose their employment. To me, this would tend to contradict the statement taken from the Electoral Office Northern Ireland Business Plan 2015-16. In closing, we must all recognise that the staff in our regional electoral offices do work of significant importance, not just at election time, but right throughout the year. We have to understand that if many of our electoral office servers are centralised in Belfast, then engagement with the wider Northern Ireland public would be severely impacted. We all want to see more and more people engaging with the political process and exercising their vote. By closing our regional electoral offices, we will only be further hindered in our efforts to encourage vote registration and political engagement. If these closures, Mr Deputy Speaker, take place, I firmly believe that democracy in Northern Ireland will be dealt a severe blow. This cannot be allowed to happen, and as no one benefits from democracy being damaged, and I would support the motion and encourage everyone in this chamber to support the motion before us today. Thank you.
Iarm Saoire Michaela Boyle. I call Michaela Boyle.
Gor Morgat, and Leis Cean Coilia. Speaking today on the amendment, as a party, we feel strongly that the electoral services and provisions should be close to the people and indeed communities here, particularly in the rural areas like Omagh, Strabane and Fermanagh and South Tyrone. The proposals to close six regional electoral offices should and cannot go ahead. And that is a message I think that we need to be sending clear today to the NIO. For anyone to suggest that this proposal is to move to high technology online voter registration system, in my opinion, will not work. It won't work in my area and it won't work in areas of West Tyrone, where in this day and age we still do not have the proper broadband infrastructure or that modern technology that this proposal talks about. And indeed, the member who brought the motion, who spoke on the motion, Mr Buchanan, is bringing an adjournment debate here to the House tomorrow just on the lack of broadband services in West Tyrone. So it begs the question, how will that be in terms of people getting registered online? It won't happen in my area. Already people are being disenfranchised in West Tyrone and Fermanagh, South Tyrone without the proper broadband services. And this is putting people's fundamental right to vote at stake. I have been elected representative since 2010. My office and indeed others in the chamber have worked well with Omagh's Chief Electoral Officer, Martin Fox, and his staff, who provide an excellent service, not just at election time, but it's an all-round year service that they provide. And to take away this service locally will have devastating consequences for democracy. The right to vote, as it's been said, is a fundamental human right, but there still remains a lot of people out there that are continually disenfranchised by not being registered to vote. They are minority groups, young people, homeless people, people who are disabled, and many others who lack access to a vote for a variety of reasons, including poverty, literacy, and not understanding the electoral process or fear of the process. However, one way of combating disenfranchisement is the growth of staff within our electoral offices and staff with the expertise in this area, providing and reassuring the public and giving them face-to-face contact with the information that they need and help with filling out forms and getting electoral ID. So this is what the Omagh Electoral Office does, and this is what they do, as I said, on a day-on, day-out basis. Supporting our party's amendment, calling on the executive to pursue the transfer of functions of the electoral offices, ensuring funding and accountability, will help the staff and electoral office do that very process and helping people with forms, etc. As it already has been stated by others here today, over the last 6 years, the electoral offices have had a reduction already within their budgets and a further 17% proposed by 2020. Already, you would say this has been done by stealth over a number of years. Particularly, I want to speak in relation to your office in Omagh. West Tyrone has had its fair share of cuts and job losses in the public sector, and we already feel vulnerable, and the people of West Tyrone and Fermanagh, South Tyrone, are extremely angry and annoyed at this. And like others said, I stood in the picket line with Martin Fox and his staff and other members of my party recently when they held their pickets outside their offices. And people are telling us that they are extremely angry and concerned about the service losing, the service being lost in our area. We have already in Strabane lost our courthouse, or proposal to lose our courthouse, and I'm glad to say that a JR has been brought forward by the legal profession in relation to that, and I hope they're successful and I fully support that JR. So how many more services has to be eroded from our constituency? And just to conclude, NIPSA and the unions are also calling on management to conduct a full accommodation review to consider options to co-locate their electoral offices into council offices. And I think this is an option that we should explore. Yeah, I will. Thank you.
Will the member agree that it's highly unlikely that any of these proposals have been rule-proofed in light of the recent passing of the Rural Needs Act that these proposals should be reconsidered?
The member has an extra minute added to her time.
Yeah, can I thank the member for his intervention? And yes, he's absolutely right. This proposal, as far as I'm aware, has not been rural-proofed, and that's something that we also need to explore in relation to the closure, particularly in Omagh and their office. So, Cancol, your vote is your voice, and it's every citizen's right to have a say in their future and how their country is run and governed. And to me, it seems personal when a body like the NIO tries to take away that very right or deny anyone the right to vote, and that's exactly what will happen. I believe it's discrimination against the person. A healthy democracy ensures that all members of the public can have equal access to the political process. And if this proposal does go forward and go ahead,
would you ask the member to draw remarks?
I believe
to
the
NIO
are putting obstacles in the way of people's right to vote. Gur Malgut.
Call George Robinson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I find myself speaking to a motion that has similarities to the removal of the DVLA office from Coleraine and the proposed courthouse in Limavady. Valley. To see more jobs removed from the regions of Northern Ireland is unacceptable, and yet again will, I believe, see a reduction in the already stretched services constituencies receive. We must also remember that these decisions have been taken without any proper and full consultation, absolutely and totally undemocratic. I can testify to the importance and value of the regional offices, especially during election time, and we must remember a local office has the local knowledge and relationships with parties that can prove to be invaluable. Mr. Deputy Speaker, to remove this service would be a false economy and indeed limit the value of the Electoral Office in Northern Ireland. I appreciate the service, advice and support the Londonderry Office gives to myself and my staff, and I am sure many other MLAs and elected representatives will provide testament to the regional office's value. Often I and my East Londonderry colleagues have organised registration events with the regional office, and I would believe that this close working could be removed with a centralised office in Belfast. But I take this opportunity to commend the staff who work in the Londonderry office. They all provide a very good service. I want to see more people on the register and voting. That, I believe, will be undermined by centralising the service, something the Baines report was opposed to. I would ask the Minister if he can guarantee that the registration work done with schools is to continue. Hopefully this is an important means of engaging with our young people in the democratic process. Mr Deputy Speaker, the motion states that the Northern Ireland office, I quote, and the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland retain and fund adequately all regional offices. I wholeheartedly support this view. Democracy has to begin at a local level. Therefore, regional offices who understand the regions they cover are essential. I wholeheartedly support the motion as proposed by my colleagues.
I call Mike Nesbitt.
Speaker, thank you very much. I rise to support the motion, but not the amendment, and in doing so, apologise for missing the start of this important debate. And it is important because we're talking about an institution whose key functions include voter registration and the accurate return of election results. And we expect them to do that informed by a set of values, values including accuracy, impartiality, professionalism, efficiency, and dare I say, when sometimes tetchy candidates are prowling the halls waiting for the declarations, displaying endless patience and courtesy. And have we any issues with the Electoral Office in those regards? Well, perhaps we could test their delivery against performance as reported by the Chief Electoral Officer in his latest annual report for 2014-15, where he makes reference to no fewer than 22 targets and development objectives. And the only failures, and there were only a couple, Mr Speaker, were reported against third-party failure and therefore beyond the control of the Electoral Office. And maybe we could benchmark that against the performance of the last executive and their failures with regard to the Social Investment Fund and childcare and the development of May's long cash, which has nothing to do with Danny Kennedy, as the member will well
know. Can I remind members to address their comments through the chair, please?
Certainly, Mr Speaker. Through the chair, I would ask the man speaking from a sedentary position to check his facts. Now, the number one target amongst the 22 was with regard to getting more electors on the electoral rota. And they succeeded in spades with a five-figure sum. So I think they're doing a pretty good job raising the question, why change? Well, it's something the Northern Ireland Office is not very forthcoming about, Mr Deputy Speaker. I stood with my colleague Philip Smith in Newtownards a couple of weeks ago in support of the staff of the Newtownards office, and they reported a huge lack of information flow coming from the NIO about why they wanted to change. One thing that was made clear is that we do things differently from Great Britain. Well, if that's the argument, surely we should pack up the devolved institutions and go back to direct rule from Westminster. That is no argument. The second question is, will people travel to Belfast to register to vote? Well, it's hard enough to get them into Newtownards, Deputy Speaker. Then the argument is perhaps they will go online. Well, the anecdotal evidence from England is that they need more staff there because people are filling in their online forms inaccurately, and they need staff to contact them to point out the inaccuracies and walk them through completing the forms accurately. And as we've heard from other speakers, internet access is a huge issue in parts, and particularly the rural parts of Northern Ireland. So we are effectively, de facto, potentially disenfranchising a large section of our people. I will give way to the member.
I thank the member for giving way, and he's highlighting, you know, we should ask the question, what's our problems with our current system? We don't have enough young people registering, and a solution is online registration. But to switch wholly to that By solving one problem, do we not risk creating a new one for older people and rural people?
The member has an extra minute added to his time.
Registration is fine if you have the facilities and the capacity to do it. So we need to have broadband access right across Northern Ireland. And we also have to take into account some people will not want to do it. I understand, for example, the PSNI's firearms and explosives branch want future licences for firearms to be exclusively online. Well, this may potentially exclude people whose enjoyment comes from having firearms from the enjoyment of that sport. It should be a choice, not something compulsory. There is, of course, the question that's been raised, is this all about saving money, Mr. Speaker? Well, let's look at the 2014-15 returns. This is the Electoral Office. It's a 2.3 million business. More than half that money goes on the staff, basic pay, overtime, employers' national insurance, accrued superannuation, the rest. We're told there are no plans for redundancies at this stage. The Arch staff have been told they will be invited to travel to Belfast. So where are the savings? It's not in that half of the pie. So is it in telecommunications? Is it going to be in printing, stationery, postage? The latter three adding up to £200,000 a year. Or is it going to be in premises? Well, it's only just more expensive than printing, stationery, or postage at £243,000. But that includes headquarters. And the figures are not disaggregated to tell us about ARDS and the other sub-regional centres that are under threat at the moment. But what is clear is that if there are savings, it's small beer, Mr. Deputy Speaker, but at a huge risk, because that target one I mentioned saw 15,993 more electors on the December 14 register than the year previously. So without clarity from the Northern Ireland office, the savings from these proposed closures could be as little as £1 for every new registered voter. And the risk, of course, is that under a new regime, you get no new voters and the electoral roll not only ceases to grow, but starts to shrink.
Would the member draw his remarks to a close, please?
Efficient and cost-effective, Mr. Speaker. But above all, let us make it easy for the voter, easy for the voter, to register and exercise their democratic right.
Iarm Sir Kiva Archibald, the call Kiva Archibald.
I welcome the opportunity to speak in support of the motion and the amendment proposed by my colleagues and myself, because it's important that we have local accountability for the administrations of elections here in the north, which could be achieved by bringing the functions of the electoral offices under the control of the executive. Mr. Deputy Speaker, at a time when we seek to devolve more powers to local government to improve delivery and accountability at a local level, it seems a contradiction to be seeking to centralise the services of the electoral offices. The reasons for and benefits of decentralised public services are well known: improved efficiency and effectiveness by having service delivered by regional managers. This, of course, depends on the professional ability of those managers, and I'm sure, Mr. Deputy Speaker, many of us in this chamber would undoubtedly speak highly of the quality professional service we've received from our local electoral offices, which benefit from years of experience in delivering their services. On the other hand, centralised services, such as those being proposed, are often criticised for rigidity in procedures, longer decision-making times, and lacking an ability to adapt to local situations and needs. As much as any other public service, electoral services should be delivered at a local level. The ability of individuals to exercise their democratic rights in terms of exercising the right to vote could be undermined by the closure of local electoral offices. And although I am certainly in favour of making use of technology to improve and streamline services and service delivery, this should ultimately go hand in hand with human resources. Some of the services, and others in the House has already touched on this, currently delivered by electoral offices at a local level could not be delivered online, for example, processing of photo ID applications at the local office. It's not reasonable to expect individuals from right across the north to travel to Belfast to access this service. It's therefore vital that no matter what, the electoral office maintains its connection with local communities and schools to ensure individuals are in fact able to obtain IDs and postal proxy votes and registrations as required. There's no substitute, however, Mr. Speaker, for a local office which gives individuals a personal service, and my party colleague, Mr. Mackay, has already given an example, but I'll give another. On election day in May this year, I was contacted by a constituent around 7 p.m. who told me her husband's postal vote hadn't arrived. Despite being an elderly gentleman in poor health, he went along to the polling station to vote, but was told he could not vote because he was on the postal list. I contacted the electoral office and was informed his postal vote definitely had been sent out. To cut a long story short, over the next hour, it transpired the gentleman's postal vote had went to his son's house, which is right next door to his own, and they have the same name. I contacted the electoral office again and was told it would not be accepted at the polling station, but could be hand-delivered to our local electoral office in Derry. And that's exactly what he did. The gentleman exercised his democratic right to vote, and it's unlikely that that would have been a case if the only electoral office in the north was in Belfast. So in conclusion, Mr Deputy Speaker, I would encourage everyone to respond to the consultation once it opens and put forward the arguments for maintaining local electoral offices. I'm happy to be speaking in support of the motion and the amendment and would urge all members to do the same. Gormagat.
I call William Irwin.
I am concerned, like many other members of the House today, by the proposals to close electoral offices across the province. As someone who operates a busy constituency office, and of course given our love of elections in Northern Ireland, having an electoral office within a suitable distance is absolutely vital. I have found it very useful, especially in situations where constituents wish to register to vote or change their address, and have the convenient option of travelling a few miles to Banbridge in order to speak directly to an electoral office staff member. That has been a tremendous benefit to people who, for example, wish to obtain an electoral identity card and do so at their local electoral office, where their picture can be taken free of charge. It is also useful that in proving address or identity details, this can be done within the electoral office setting to save sending important documents by post.
Would the member agree that a once-off opportunity for the workers in the electoral office to press home their point with the British authorities will arise this Thursday and Friday, when electoral office workers will be expected to work late into the night to deliver the verdict on the European referendum? If they were to decide, and I urge them from this place so to decide, to take industrial action on that day, would that not do more to bring attention to their case and the validity of their case than anything that might be said or done in this House? A nil-all result in the European referendum would be a big win for the electoral office workers and for all of us.
The member has an extra minute added to his speaking team.
Okay, and the member makes his point. Someone without this documentation for a period of time prior to his return, this is only made possible by having an electoral office in the locality with face-to-face contact with electoral staff. Members, we are all aware of the many deadlines that exist in the run-up to an election and how confusing this can be for the public. It is when deadlines are drawing to a close that the local electoral office really proves its value. I can only imagine the sheer number of people who will be left without a vote in such circumstances, where they have, for one reason or another, left registration or applying for a postal vote to the last minute. I fear that a trip for someone in Newton Hamilton down to Belfast to a central electoral office with perhaps a registration form, particularly if that person is working or caring for someone, or indeed if that person was elderly, would pose a significant problem. I really do feel that under the closure proposals, it will affect people's democratic participation. That is something that should be avoided. Indeed, the electoral office in Northern Ireland has done tremendous work, along with elected representatives, to increase participation in the democratic process. And we have seen considerable increases in registration due to various awareness campaigns. It would surely be a retrograde step to then make access to the very service that ensures your right to vote much more difficult. On that basis, I would fully support the motion in asking that this closure proposal be halted and the future of elected offices across the province be secured to ensure that participation in the democratic process is encouraged and facilitated through easily accessible localised services. I support the motion.
I call Carla Lockhart.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I rise to support my colleagues in the motion put forward today. As someone who represents the Upper Ban constituency, obviously where one of the electoral offices are located in Banbridge, I rise obviously to say that I would also support the retention of these offices in these local areas. We have all been through an election and we have all recognised the value that these offices bring to our constituents. I know on a daily basis I would have people within my constituency office asking for information around voting registration, around postal votes, around ID cards, and I believe having that face-to-face contact within an area which is which people can travel to really via public transport or via their own methods is vitally, vitally important. It's important that we as elected people encourage voter registration, and I believe that if we're stripping our local towns off these offices, it actually will do nothing to ensure that young people and people that live within our constituencies actually take that step to register. As a young person, certainly, who was just recently elected, I think we need to be doing more to engage. And I certainly do think that the entire electoral registration system does need reform, but that does not in any way mean that we strip our local towns of that particular service. I do believe that online voting registration should be improved and enhanced and introduced in Northern Ireland, because I think there's a section of the community that actually would benefit from that. But I also recognise that we cannot solely leave it to online voter registration because of the issues around rural constituencies and the access to broadband. So I do recognise that there does need to be reform and that we do need to change how we do things, but certainly that does not in any way mean stripping our areas off these offices. I just took the opportunity this morning to contact our local office, and in the Upper Ban constituency there are 85,753 people registered. And at the last election, I noted with interest that over 12,776 people were registered under late registration. I think it's vitally important that we note those statistics and we recognise that those offices are servicing those people in the best way possible. I want to commend the staff that work out of Banbridge. I think they are fantastic. They do a very good job in servicing the people and us as elected representatives and in handling elections. So I want to just wholeheartedly support the efforts that are being made to retain these services. We also think of what they do around going into schools and encouraging our young people to get onto the register and to exercise their democratic right. The most important thing I believe that people will do in this society is cast their vote for a party that they believe aligns with their policies. And we have got to make it easy for people to be able to do this. And to do that, I believe that we should be retaining our local offices. We see 4 full-time staff and 9 part-time staff in the Banbridge office who potentially could lose their jobs who are going to be required to drive to Belfast, which will impact their family life. We talk about encouraging and enhancing family life within the home, and certainly asking people to do this, I believe, is unreasonable. So I would call on those who are making this decision to think long and hard about it and do what is right by the people of Northern Ireland and not always think of the small amount of money that they may save if they proceed down this route. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Éireann Sir John O'Dowd, I call John O'Dowd.
Gourmet Ogut, last can call you. Has this decision been taken by the Electoral Office to improve democracy? No, it hasn't. It has been taken because of austerity. The ANIO have cut the funding to the Electoral Office, and the Electoral Office is then in a position where it's trying to recoup savings out of what is already a limited budget. And Mr. Nesbitt read out some of the budget headlines there and asked where would those savings be made. So talk of a turn to a fully electronic system where people register online, where people have their postal and proxy votes online, where we have photo ID processed online, is all a side issue. This is about the Conservative government cutting funding to the NAO and the NAO cutting funding to the electoral office. So it has nothing to do with democracy. And in fact, what it actually does is impedes upon democracy. Because as many speakers have already said here today, it is becoming more and more difficult to vote in this society. It is becoming more and more difficult to get on the register. Once you're on the register, it becomes more difficult to get the proper ID. And once you've achieved all that, then you have to go through the process of voting in an archaic way in many, compared to many other societies. So today's motion is about protecting democracy. It is about protecting the right of people to register, to have photographic ID and to be able to vote. Many speakers have quite rightly commended the work of the regional electoral offices. But I have to say this, despite their very valiant efforts, there is not enough done to ensure people are on the register. There is not enough engagement with our post-primary schools. There is not enough electoral registration and active, proactive canvassing out there to ensure that people are on the register. During the most recent Assembly elections, I know in my own area, when we called for electoral ID clinics to be held and registration clinics to be held, they were torn down. And why were they torn down? Because even at that stage, they didn't have enough staff and resources. Those clinics went ahead, and several hundred people were registered because they were organised by local community groups. Local community groups came together and did the work of what should be carried out by the electoral office. And several hundred people, therefore, had the option to vote who otherwise would have been denied. So I do commend the work of those in the offices. But let's be very, very clear. Even now, with those regional offices, there is not enough being done to ensure that people are on the register and to ensure that citizens have the democratic right to vote. And the closure of these offices is not going to assist that. It is going to actively make the situation worse. When myself and Catherine Seeley joined the picket line outside the office in Banbridge, when staff were taking industrial action, they themselves were coming forward with alternatives. The staff themselves were saying, why don't we share accommodation with the local council? Why is there not more imagination put into this? Because the savings that they're trying to achieve is through leases and rents on the regional offices. So the staff themselves, standing in that picket line, were being more imaginative than the electoral office was being in this case, because they wanted to keep the offices local. They recognised that there had to be savings made, but they also recognised that the key work they carried out needed to be carried out locally and people have accessibility to it. So that brings me on to the amendment. What is there to fear from the executive pursuing the transfer of functions of the electoral office? I remember when, during negotiations a long time ago, that when we brought forward the proposal that the transfer of policing and justice powers should be brought forward. Now, did I know or did any of our delegation know that the fine detail of that? No. Had the T's crossed and the I's dotted? No. But what happened after that was there was negotiation around what that framework would look like, what inbuilt protections there would be. Mr Ford is concerned about the independence of such a move. That independence would have to be protected. And how do you protect it? Because the legislation to transfer the powers would have to come through this Assembly. So there is inbuilt protections for everyone involved. The SDLP are going to oppose the amendment. I'm not sure why they're opposing the amendment. Do they not have confidence in their own abilities as legislators to ensure that the powers and governance of the electoral system are protected? I'm nearly out of time. And as legislators around the chamber, we are the defenders of democracy in this society. We are elected to participate in democracy.
Well, the member draws remarks to a close.
And the transfer of powers to this assembly is the way forward, because standing up, and Mr Nesbitt actually said himself, the NAO were not very forthcoming in their response. But
time
Mr
up
Nesbitt
for the member.
Oppose the amendment. Mr Nesbitt should support the amendment in that case. Thank you very much.
Okay. I call Steve Aiken.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I rise to support the motion, but not the amendment. I'm new to the electoral process, and the support of the office in Newtownabbey give me was absolutely invaluable. For me as a candidate, and also for my election team, who are able to understand a lot more about the electoral process and work with the South Antrim. It's helped considerably with my constituents, both for the Assembly and also for the forthcoming EU referendum. It has been absolutely important for people to be able to do face-to-face and to be able to discuss about registration, how it's managed to do that as well. But it was interesting listening to the discussion today about looking at some of the issues and some of the costs. If some of the costs of the region are less than £250,000 when looking at potential housing electoral offices, the offer of using facilities at council facilities, I think, is an excellent idea. And it's one that I would encourage the Northern Ireland Office to look at and looking forward as well. We know we've got significant problems of broadband provision. And if South Antrim has got anything to go by, I understand that that's going to be very difficult to be able to make online to be an appropriate way of looking at how we're going to provide these provisions going forward in the future. So the question I have is, why are we doing this? What is the actual practical value of doing this? What is the problem of creating instability in the system? What is any of the savings that are likely to be made? And why can we not oppose this and make this happen as well? I think we should reconsider this, as this series of closures appears to be contrary to the provision of regional and our own democratic process. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah. I call Mervyn Storey.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And can I rise in support of my colleagues and commend them for putting in the motion? In relation to that, can I say that it follows on from a promise that was made to the staff in the electoral offices that we would take this issue to the floor of this House, and I think that that's to be welcomed. There are a few comments I want to make in relation to the amendment, because I notice that Mr. Mackay made reference to the fact that we should go for the amendment because it ensured local accountability and the NIO wasn't accountable and there was all these problems. However, the same member has no difficulty when it comes to supporting the Parades Commission, most unaccountable organisation in Northern Ireland, and in a few weeks' time he'll put in through the door of the Parades Commission. He'll tell unaccounted, unelected individuals his woes, and he'll want them to act upon it, and then we'll not know the reasons why they did it, the reasons why they did certain things. So, of course, you know, double standards knows no bounds when it comes to sometimes these issues. So let's not get carried away too much with the issue about us being champions for accountability. Need a wee bit of consistency on that issue. Yes, happy to give way.
Point out to the member, we're more than happy to see the devolution and the transfer of powers in regard to parades as well. And if the member's party would like to hold further discussions with us about that issue, we'll be welcome to sit down with you.
I will be happy that
the member has an extra minute added to his
is
time.
Placed where it rightfully belongs, in the Sadducees' grave, where there is no resurrection. And I can assure you that it is a day that should come very quickly, because it is the most useless organisation that this country has ever had. And I can tell you, we've had some useless organisations. Mr. Nesbitt, turning now to Mr. Nesbitt and the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party, maybe those two things are he wanted me to rewrite history, that somehow Danny Kennedy wasn't a member of the executive when he made reference to the fact that there was a previous executive. Well, I'm glad that he was only giving this House today advice in relation to the electoral office, and he wasn't giving us advice on how you run elections, and that he wasn't the director of an electoral campaign. Because let's go, and Mr. Nesbitt did make some valid points, because this is an issue of concern in terms of the removal of a service that has already been reduced. In my own constituency, and I made reference to it, we lost the electoral office in Ballymena. Now they're proposing to take it out of Ballymena. Even when there was on the table a proposal, as the member for North Antrim has referred to, in relation to what office accommodation could be offered in Braid. And I hope that that still will be seriously considered, because if it is about savings, there are savings that can be made. But let me conclude by paying tribute to the staff in the electoral office. I believe, yes, I think I would like to see the votes counted a bit quicker, and maybe that would reduce the overall burden, because I still do think we need to have a quicker process in terms of the way that we count our votes. However, that doesn't take away from the professionalism, the independence, and that is an important issue, because let's remember there were those in the past who were quite happy to abuse the electoral system, and that's why we need to ensure that in Northern Ireland we have an independent, robust and accountable electoral system, which we currently receive in terms of our electoral office. I support the motion, but not the amendment.
I call Jim Allister, and the member has up to 2 minutes.
Thank you. An accessible electoral office is an indispensable part of a workable democratic process, because it's there to facilitate those who wish to inquire about registration, to facilitate registration, to return their postal ballots, etc. And if you draw that out and centralise it to one point, then you diminish the interface between the electorate and the functioning of the election. And that is a retrograde step. And this, therefore, is a retrograde step, and one which the Northern Ireland office should certainly not proceed with, because it is going to diminish the electoral experience in Northern Ireland, and that's not in the interest. So I totally back the motion. I think the amendment is wholly misguided, because the electoral office and its affairs are accepted matters. It oversees elections not just to this House, but to Westminster. And it would be an absurd proposition if the oversight of those elections as part of the functions of the electoral office would be transferred to this devolved House when it oversees elections to the sovereign parliament as well. So there's good reason why it is an accepted matter, and that's how it has to and must remain. But that is not good reason for diminishing the service and making it less efficient and less effective. And in the case of Ballymena, we've lost so much. We've not lost the courthouse, if the Vice Minister has
his way. Would the member draw his remarks to a close, please?
We've lost many big manufacturing, and now we're going to diminish it further by losing the electoral office. I trust the offer from the local council to facilitate it will be taken, and that this facility will be saved.
Éirim Sir, Michel Gildenew, le Críoch a Chur leis an Leasú. I ask Michel Gildenew to wind on the amendment.
Thank the members for a very robust debate, and I had took down a few notes, but I've only got 5 minutes, and I want to make my own points as well. I have to say the reason that Sinn Féin decided to put the amendment to this is because I certainly believe that the executive could carry out and transfer the functions of the electoral office and would ensure local accountability, integrity and independence that we need to see for the provision of electoral services. I'm deeply concerned by the thought that we could lose our franchise in rural constituencies. If anybody thinks for a minute that this move will make it easier for people to vote, they're very misguided. The points have been made around electoral ID clinics, schools outreach, postal and proxy votes. I'm going to mention two groups that haven't been mentioned here today. First of all, we have a very vibrant foreign national community in and around South Tyrone. And this year, a particular individual from STEP was up every day with busloads of people to get them registered, to get them onto the register to vote, to get their electoral ID. Portuguese people don't need a passport to travel within the EU. They've got an ID card that allows them to do that. They cannot vote with that ID card. They all have it. They can't vote with it. We've put that issue to the ambassador, but they don't have passports, so they absolutely need electoral ID. We also have a group of people, so there's a very vibrant foreign national community who need to have access to those offices in order to get their electoral ID. We also have a group of people, and many of you have talked about schools outreach, but young people who leave school at 16 aren't part of that. So 16 and 17-year-olds, there's always a flurry when they turn 18 and 19 to get registered, because they realise weeks and days before an election that they're not registered to vote and that they're going to miss out on their mandate. So that's two groups that are very, very strong users of the service. Like many others, I was on the picket line in Omagh, and I just want to bring to members' attention the Omagh office services, as others have made the point, from Anna South Tyrone and West Tyrone. People from Black Lion, from Garrison, aren't going to go to Belfast to leave in a postal or proxy vote form. They're not going to go to Belfast for an electoral ID card. They're going to end up not getting the opportunity to vote. Now, many of the members in this House remember a very infamous previous British Secretary of State by the name of Jeff Rooker, who brought in PPS 14, which then went on to become PPS 21. I would say Teresa Villiers knows as much about rural Ireland and cares even less than Jeff Rooker did. I don't believe that this is an improvement in the service. I believe that we absolutely need to ensure that we have that local accountability, the people working in local offices and local the ability to access a service locally that is crucial to our ability to cast our vote, to cast our democratic mandate. So we've got a very short space of time to be involved in the consultation. We need to ensure that our voices are heard across the board. The amendment is important, and the amendment, while we can call on the NIO to do more, the NIO really and truly aren't that bothered about whether somebody from Garrison gets their postal vote. We need these services transferred to this executive, enable people to have the ability to run these offices, run them in a very fair, impartial and accountable way, and to bring we have the decision making back in the north of Ireland and outside of the NIO. So I'm very agitated and anxious about this motion. I spoke about it when we were returned as MLAs in Omagh. Again, like others, the Omagh staff had made the point that the Omagh Council had offered them the use of their premises if that would help to save money. These are the kind of creative ideas we need to be looking at. We need to ensure that these offices remain open, and I believe that the amendment is important, and we need to ensure that we're not back here again in 5, 10, 15 years debating the same thing. We need to have these functions transferred to the Assembly in order for us to protect the future of rural constituents. Gormila Magov.
I call Pam Cameron to wind on the motion, please.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I rise today to support the motion and would like to thank my party colleague Paul Frew for bringing this motion to the House today. Each and every one of us in this House are here as a result from the democratic process, and we have been returned by our peers to represent the public interest and ensure their voices are heard in the development of legislation. I, for one, and I'm certain that I'm not alone, I'm extremely grateful that we have the privilege of living in a democratic society and recognise how fortunate we are that we have this freedom. Since its inception in 1972, the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland has been integral to facilitating the democratic process for the residents of Northern Ireland. It's provided a vital and fundamental role in ensuring people can easily engage, participate and contribute in the process. Without the Electoral Office for Northern Ireland, I have no doubt that we would not have the same number of people registered to vote, or that the elections would be managed as efficiently and as impartially as they currently are. I was therefore greatly concerned to learn of the plans to close the 6 regional offices, which have provided such vital community service to so many. I believe that if these plans are to proceed, we will see a decrease in our voter registration, lack of access to electoral identity cards, a fall in those participating via postal or proxy voting, and ultimately an increase in voter apathy. With the electoral turnout widely in the region of 50%, we must do all we can to ensure we make political engagement as easy and as transparent as possible in order to attempt to increase this figure and prevent any further decline. I do appreciate the Electoral Office, like so many government departments, is facing increasing financial constraints, and we must make savings in order to live within our means, but I do feel that the closure of the offices will be detrimental. I similarly appreciate the Electoral Office is moving towards digital voter registration in line with the rest of the UK, which I hope will encourage more people to register to vote. We live in a generation which is led by technology, and the ability to register to vote via the internet at any time of the day or night should be embraced for its convenience and accessibility. I sincerely hope that this will encourage more of the younger generation, who at times appear somewhat disengaged from politics, to participate. Conversely, with my experience with my own constituency office, the vast numbers of calls requesting information and guidance over voter registration and postal and proxy voting is that these are of the older generation. And my concern is that the closure of local offices will mean that these people will simply not vote as they as the once familiar process will have changed greatly. There are, of course, the inevitable job losses which could come with these office closures, and the impact that this would have on those individuals must not be forgotten. I recently received a member, as I'm sure all members did, from the Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, Ben Wallace MP, which acknowledged the importance of maintaining the ability of the electorate to exercise their democratic right, and I hope that Mr Wallace has recognised the strength of feeling within Northern Ireland to maintain local services, and that he will reflect this when it comes to the time of making his decision on the future of local offices. Mr Wallace's letter went on to talk about the possibility of closer working with local councils in order to continue to provide a local electoral service, and I sincerely hope that that should the worst case scenario be arrived at and the local offices are to close, that at very least there can be provision made for this service to be maintained, for instance, at the local council offices, and that the highly experienced electoral office staff can be redeployed to fulfil these roles. I was heartened to see that Mr Wallace refuted the speculation that the electoral services would only be available in Belfast, and hope that efforts are focused on retaining a local service. In closing, Mr Deputy Speaker, the central principle of today's motion is protecting the democratic rights of the people of Northern Ireland, and I acknowledge that there is need to reform the electoral office in order to save money, but feel that the closure of the local offices is not the way forward, and I would implore the Secretary of State and the Northern Ireland office to maintain and protect the future of these offices in order to ensure the people of Northern Ireland continue to avail of the unparalleled access to the democratic process we have been used to and have enjoyed for the past 44 years. Mr Deputy Speaker, I'm just going to move on to some of the comments from the other members in this debate, and welcome the fact that so many members have seen fit to speak on this debate, and it's certainly been well contributed to. With the proposer, Tom Buchanan, who led off the debate, and he stated he was not supporting the amendment, and he wished to work with the Secretary of State and the NIO to retain the six electoral offices. He referred to the declining turnout at the elections in Northern Ireland over time. He said he had no difficulty with the introduction of online services, but that it needed to be run in conjunction with the work of the local electoral offices. He also asked the question of who would promote the work within the community and schools that is currently being done. And he spoke of the risk to the public confidence with the online registration, and we're all aware of what has happened recently in England in regard to that process. Dahi Mackay moved the amendment and spoke about the electoral office from a public rep's point of view. He spoke about being powerless in the situation, and that's where his party's proposed amendment comes in. Robin Swan, he also spoke about the local office, in particular in North Antrim, and the fact that Ballymena is being closed before the consultation is finished. He praised the work of Mid and East Antrim Council, who have worked hard toward a solution without joy. He talked about the complete collapse of the online registration system in England last week, and that he was not supporting the amendment, and that money should be fined, at least temporarily, to ensure the Ballymena office remained open. Daniel McCrossan supported the motion and said the SDLP were standing full square behind the staff of the offices. He spoke of his concern for rural areas and asked about the provision of broadband services, and also talked about those who are not computer literate. The need to do more to encourage the public vote. David Ford, he spoke about his relationship with the local office in Newtownabbey, but he did stress the need for realism around the proposals, and he also spoke about the lack of proper consultation in this regard as well. He talked about the reduction of numbers on the register and the need to keep those numbers up. He did say that he thought the motion was unrealistic and we needed to face reality, but that we should insist on genuine consultation on the issue. Sydney Anderson also spoke in the motion and talked about the important role the electoral office plays in our democracy. He talked about the budget reduction of 25% and also as we all do, had something to say about his local office in Banbridge this time, in Upper Ban. And I think everybody's had fairly good reports of how helpful the staff have been within each and every constituency there. Michaela Boyle spoke to the amendment and she had a clear message to the NIO that the six offices should not be closed. And she talked about modern technology and broadband services in West Tyrone, or the lack of. George Robson also was contributing, and he worried about the reduction of the local services, and he spoke about the importance and value of the local office. And he said to remove that service would be a false economy. Mike Nesbitt was in support of the motion, but not the amendment. He said there was a huge lack of information flowing. Information flow coming from the Newtownards office, and question why the change, and question whether the public would travel to Belfast to register to vote. And I would severely doubt that too with bus lanes. He also referred to the firearms licensing and the proposals there to move to a completely online process, and how this won't work for all people. Kiever Archibald questioned the logic of centralising the services, and it said the electoral services should be delivered at a local level, that some of the services would not be available online, and she gave an example in particular of a constituent she had dealings with over the election period. William Irwin spoke of the services such as getting the ID card and pictures taken for free, and spoke of the electoral office.
Ask the member to draw remarks to a conclusion.
Well, indeed, value, and that fear that votes will be lost through the proposed changes. He also spoke about the tremendous work of the electoral office in Northern Ireland, and I think that's a good line to end on, because I think we all have very good things to say about the electoral staff in particular. And can I thank everybody for their contributions to this debate today. I support the motion. Thank you.
Okay, the question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. No. Aye. Okay, clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Orders, Member. Order. If members would resume their seats, please. Okay. The question is that the amendment. Order, please. The question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
I think the ayes, or sorry, the noes have it. The noes have it. Okay, if there's some view that we put it to the vote, I'll just check that again. Right? All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Okay, do we have tellers? Order, members. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Dahi Mackay and Michaela Boyle. Tellers for the noes are Sydney Anderson and George Robison. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide ayes to my right, noes to my left. Thank you. secure the doors, please. Michelle. Order, members. Members, resume their seats, please. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 84 members voted, 35 members voted aye, 49 members voted no. The amendment therefore falls.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the ayes have it. Item 6 on the order paper.